Welcome to this episode of Ireka, and this is a Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award special. In this episode, we are going to have a very wonderful conversation with Dr. Subi Jacob George. He is with Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, an institution under Department of Science and Technology. And his area of work is in an area called as supramolecular chemistry. Emerging area, very advanced area. And we thank him for being in the show. Thank you, sir, for being in the show. It's a very wonderful opportunity. First, please accept our greetings for the award that you have received.
So thank you, Dr. Venkatesan, for at the outset, let me thank you for inviting me to the program. It's a great opportunity to interact with you.
So let me first read the citation so that we'll understand what is the research work that you are doing, and then we can start our discussion. So let me read the citation. The citation says, you have provided remarkable insights into materials chemistry at various length energy and time scale, which help not only in regulating factors that govern the size, shape, chirality of supermolecules, but facilitating their applications like light emission, sensing, ion transport to design novel autonomous devices like biomolecular motors. It's very interesting. I mean, as I read, it looks like science fiction, quite obviously a frontier area of science and technology or techno-science. There are lots of terminology here which appears to make sense, but perhaps would require certain clarification. So let me start with simple questions. I mean, there is this whole area is centered on macromolecules. So we all are aware of molecules. I mean, let's say NaCl for salt or H2O for water. I mean, we are all aware of it. I mean, school, we have studied about it. So when you talk about macromolecule, how do you define it?
So let me start with your question of macromolecule. So macromolecule, if you look into it, it's simple by definition, it's a big molecule. Macro is big. So it's a big molecule. So if you look into, our surroundings, you can find many big macromolecules. Like if you look into proteins, if you look into nature. So this is a big macromolecule. Right? It's a big molecule. So it's called as a macromolecule. And if you look into polymers or plastics, like the bottles we drink water, this is polyethylene terephthalate. This is also a big molecule. So it's also a macromolecule. And so the only one difference between these two types of macromolecule is like in proteins, there is no repeating unit. So if you take a polymer, you can see that there is a repeating one monomeric sequence is getting repeated. That's why polymer comes. So although both are macromolecules, there is a significant difference between these two molecules. And let me also mention to you, 2020 was the international year of, 100th anniversary of polymer chemistry or micromolecular chemistry.
Okay.
So it was like in 1920, the concept of micromolecule was defined. And last year, 2020 was actually the 100th anniversary of polymer chemistry and micromolecular chemistry. Mm-hmm. So it's very appropriate time that you asked me to define micromolecules.
Very, very interesting. Okay, so let me go forward and then ask you a question about other terminologies which is there in your citation. One is, for example, it talks about material chemistry at various length. So what does this length actually mean?
Yeah, so let me, before I answer that, I'm like, there is a slight difference between the kind of micromolecules we work. Okay, so if you know the micromolecules or polymers, which we see around, it's wonderful. I'm like, without that, we cannot imagine a life now. I'm like, living without plastics or polymers is, I'm like, impossible. A world without them is, we cannot live in that world. But one of the on the other hand, one disadvantage of such a big high stability polymers is we know that it is an increasing sustainability issue. So because of the stability, they never decompose. And so biodegradable polymers, people are talking about recyclable polymers, people are talking about, it's a kind of increasing sustainability issue. Yeah. So in this aspect, we work on a kind of very new kind of micromolecules. Okay, so that comes to the other kind of definitions in the citations. Mm-hmm. And one is kind of self-assembly. Okay. Okay, so what we do is, instead of doing these big micromolecules where each molecule is linked by very strong covalent bonds, mm-hmm. what we work is which are linked by very weak bonds. Okay, so we take a simple molecules, we assemble them by very weak interactions. Mm-hmm. Like if you take, I don't know whether in if you look into nature also, there are full of in biological system, there are many such assemblies.
Okay.
Self-assemblies, mm-hmm. which is small molecules come together and form large micromolecules. Okay. So they are held together by weak interactions. Okay. You take a example of DNA, mm-hmm. or DNA, if you look into the example, like DNA is held together by something called weak hydrogen bonding. And hydrogen bonding also exists in water molecules. Okay. Yeah. So if you think about, if you can assemble these molecules by these weak interactions, we can, in principle, we can get this micromolecules. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, since they are weak, means we can easily break them.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So a subtle change in environment can uh-huh. completely break it up, and probably we can recycle back the entire monomers. So it's a kind of new concepts which is called supramolecular chemistry, which is also another term in the in the citation. So supramolecular chemistry is actually the chemistry beyond the molecule.
Okay.
So it's not a single molecule anymore. Uh-huh. We organize molecules, self-assemble molecules by these weak interactions. Uh-huh. So, and if you look into nature or cell or biological system, I mean, most, like if you take cell membrane, mm-hmm. if you take protein assemblies, they are all assemblies. They're not single molecule.
Yeah.
They all come together by weak interactions and making large structures. And that's responsible for most of its functions. So that kind of micromolecules we are working on. And that is called, we call it as supramolecular polymers.
Uh-huh.
So I'll come back to that later in detail.
Yeah. So you used a word called self-assembly, right?
Yeah.
I mean, what does it mean? I mean, can you illustrate with the example so that we'll be able to understand it better?
Yeah. So self-assembly is like, if you take, suppose if you are molecule, mm-hmm. you give kind of an ability to interact with another molecule by very weak interactions. Like as I mentioned, it can be an hydrogen bonding, it can be a simple hydrophobic interaction. So then if you put that molecule into a solvent or something like that, so immediately many things will come together and assemble. Okay, so that is like a self-assembly. I'm like, so you program the molecule in such a way that it has the ability to find its partner. Or it can we call it as a kind of molecular recognition. So you can recognize another molecule by weak interactions. So we can just, then they will come and form large structures like micromolecules. So that is basically the self-assembly.
So just to check whether my understanding is right. I say, for example, detergent and water.
Yeah.
The moment I put detergent in water, and then if there is a soil cloth inside it, the detergent molecule, one part of it actually goes and hooks onto the dirt. The other portion hooks onto the water, and then it forms a kind of a small spherical structure, right? Encasing the dirt. So it's a kind of self-assembly. It's not something that you create, right?
Yeah. So you brought out a kind of, that's the best example you can explain in a kind of simple way. So that is, this detergent is a kind of molecule. It has polar part, which likes water, and it has a non-polar part, which does not like water.
Yeah.
So when they put it into water, they come together and call this spherical, we call it as a micelle, a micellar system. So that is a beautiful example of self-assembly. And if you look into kind of all the cell membranes, the lipid molecules are like surfactants, and they form large assembly. So this is a wonderful example.
That's interesting. So now let me go back to that same question from which we digress. I mean, it says about molecular chemistry, I mean, material chemistry at length, energy and time scale.
Yeah.
So what does that mean?
Sure. So let me come back to that supramolecular polymers we work on. Okay.
Yeah.
So why we started working on this supramolecular polymers is, if you look into biological system or cellular systems, so you look into these protein assemblies. Anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So most of these functions are determined by this kind of large supramolecular polymers. Okay. So the objective for us was to mimic such things synthetically in the laboratory. So we started taking principles from cellular systems, not to mimic it or not to construct a cell, but just to take an inspiration from cell and try to mimic that in our laboratory. Okay. So when we start doing it, we can be never clever as the nature. So when we start making it, this field is active probably last 2 decades. So initial attempts in this field is like, we can make them. So we can, as a chemist or as an organic chemist, we can tell or program molecules to assemble. But when we start doing that, we don't have any structural control. Mm-hmm. But what I mean is we cannot control its length. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you look into nature, if you look at protein assemblies and everything, they are all a particular length.
Yeah.
That means they are all monodisperse. We call it as a term called monodisperse. That means if you take 100 of them, all of them will be having same length.
Yeah.
But when we make in the lab, there will be always polydisperse. So they will have multiple lengths. Mm-hmm. So if you want to really mimic some of these functions of the cell, we have one of the first challenges to control the length of these supramolecular polymers. Okay. So we need to have clever strategies for that. So that is one of the challenges for this field to go forward, or like you can control the molecular weight of the systems. So that is the first challenge. That is the length part you read out in the citations. And the other aspect is the time scale.
Yeah. Okay.
So when it comes to time scales, if you look into, again, I would like to look back to the cellular systems. Mm-hmm. So there are two aspects which we should learn. One is organization, which we talked about self-assembly.
Yeah.
And there is another important aspect, that is dynamics, or continuous movement. So although we get advice that we should get equilibrium, but then if you go inside the cellular world, it's always out of equilibrium, right? Like it's always dynamic processes are happening.
Yeah.
So this particular aspect is the time scale. In the sense, if you make a material, it should not be, it's nice that it is stable forever. We can have many applications out of this. But if you want to make something like life-like material, we should move away from this equilibrium. Mm-hmm. Equilibrium is death, obviously. And we should move away from equilibrium and to out of equilibrium. So we should talk about dynamics, which then time scales are involved. So that is one of the beauty of these supramolecular polymers. So always these molecules go and come back. So the dynamics has many advantages. I can come back to that later.
Yeah. Good. Keep watching, Eureka. We'll take a very short break. After the break, this interesting conversation will continue. Welcome back to Eureka. We were having a very interesting conversation with Dr. Subi Jacob George. He is a professor at Jawaharlal Nehru Center for Advanced Scientific Research, an organization under Department of Science and Technology. And he has been awarded the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in Material Sciences for the year 2020. So the way you have been describing, as I can see it, I mean, it is somewhere between chemistry and biology. But your award is for material science. Many of us would find this as a bit misplaced. I mean, I'm quite sure it's not misplaced. So we are not really getting the idea of why it is material science. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure, definitely. That's a wonderful question. So you are absolutely right. We take principles from cellular world because we, as I mentioned, this is not an attempt to probably make a cell, but to take cell as an inspiration and learn the smart designs from nature and try to implement in synthetic system so that we can make smarter materials. So that is the way we work on. So when I make comparisons with cell, don't confuse that. I'm like, I'm going to synthesize a cell tomorrow. That was not the objective.
Yeah, yeah.
So coming back to that dynamics aspect I was talking about, then you will understand how it is related to the material chemistry. So one of the beauty of this cellular system is if there is a damage in the system, it can self-repair.
Okay.
So that is mainly because of the dynamics of the molecules I was talking about involved. So there are always kind of movement, and so they will always try to repair a damage which happens inside the cell. Uh-huh. So think about a material like that. Okay, so we can make a material like a polymeric systems, which you can use in a kind of car paint or something like that. Uh-huh. And there is a scratch.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so whenever I'm like, if there is a scratch, if there is a material which can self heal uh-huh. without doing anything else, it would be fantastic, right? So we can,
so if something like, say for example, if I have a scratch on my skin.
Yeah.
I mean, if it is the top skin, it heals on itself, right? I mean,
yeah, exactly.
So you're talking something like that. Okay.
Yeah. Something like that. So if you make a real material, and this is not possible if the bonds are very rigid, like classical polymers. So if you make a cut, that is a cut. It cannot come back and join together. So on the other hand, when you talk about this kind of supramolecular polymers, if there is a cut, but since there is a dynamics of the molecules involved, they will always come back and rejoin and try to self-heal.
Okay,
so that's something which is nice, and this is a kind of smart material. That is one kind of materials we are working on, okay. Self-healable materials. Uh-huh. So I was talking about this out-of-equilibrium materials.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so if you look into the motivation is, again, in the cell, there is something called actin protein, which is important for the movement. It's a filamentous protein. So the beauty of the system is always, so it assembles and disassembles. Assembles, disassembles. So it happens as a kind of autonomous way. So if you can make something similar in synthetic system,
mm-hmm.
okay. Yeah. So you can think about something, a kind of material called transient material. Transient is a material which has a definite lifetime. After that, that material just disappears. Okay. So for example, just think about, I've taken an example of Mission Impossible movie where Tom Cruise, the film series, always get a kind of message, self-destructing device. After the message, the device just bursts, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So think about a material, semiconducting material or something like that we make out of this transient material. Mm-hmm. And you define the lifetime of the material in advance.
Yeah.
Okay, so you can program the lifetime of a material.
Okay.
And that is possible only when you move away from equilibrium to out of equilibrium. So again, the principles are completely from...
So it is also like, for example, like the nucleus sends a messenger RNA.
Yeah.
It is in the cell only for a short duration. Once its job is over, I mean, it is recycled. Yeah. The materials are broken into parts and then... the chemicals are not wasted, I mean, but it is recycled, but
recycled.
It doesn't stay forever, right? I mean, you are talking about something like that, right?
Yeah. It is stable only for to perform that function.
Yeah, yeah.
After function performing, it's a beautiful concept. So if you think about, if we can introduce into the material world, we can make something called transient material. So that's something, one other aspect we are working on, especially.
So now, coming back to the point that you were making, which was underlying when you were explaining, but now it's becoming very clear. When you were saying about smart, in earlier time, we thought smart is something which will last forever. Which will be very hard, which will be stable for a long time. But I think we are learning a lot from life and seeing that it's not being strong, which is smarter. It's being flexible, which is actually smart. I mean, our understanding of the smartness itself has changed, right?
Yeah, yeah. So I agree to you completely. So when you say that nature is smarter than us, so I would... slightly redefine the definition of the smarter. I would say that any material which can adapt according to the situation, think, adapt, and evolve. Probably that would be the definition of a smarter material, which is exactly something in the nature. I think probably that's the kind of new material we should work on.
And also, I mean, it can be recycled. I mean, there is a circularity.
Yeah. So this is all about circular economy. I think that's very important, especially when it comes to the polymer chemistry world. The sustainability, the plastic waste is a big concern for all of us. I'm talking about only the properties of polymers. So think about a situation where we can completely recycle it, reprocess it. Even I'm not talking about biodegradability. That is again going into, that takes a long time. So think about but it's not at there, I would say that. Probably it will take 2 to 3 decades where at least 20% of the existing plastic usage, if you want to replace with these smarter materials, it will take time. But I think that's a nice way to go forward.
Like, for example, iron, we actually almost never waste it, right? I mean, once you use it, once it becomes either rusted or you are not going to use it, I mean, you take it away, recycle it, make a new product. So, I mean, there is a circularity for metal. So you're looking at plastics as a kind of circularity rather than saying that, okay, I'll do a safe disposal. I mean, it's not about only safe disposal, but actually reusing the same material so that actually we don't create waste.
So if no need not to be for the same applications, we should be in a position to reprocess it for something else also, like the iron example you mentioned. So that would be the perfect solution for circular economy.
So now let me come to your research work. I mean, with this kind of material, what are all the kinds of things that you are aiming to address?
So far, as I mentioned, this field is a kind of relatively new field. It's a promising field. So permolecular chemistry itself is a relatively young field in the chemistry community. But then moving away from equilibrium to non-equilibrium, probably the entire concept has started probably last 5 years. So what we are targeting is, so far, the initial attempts in this field was to get a complete understanding on how it works, like assembly, disassembly, monomer exchange dynamics. So that was from a purely fundamental point of view. So we got a hold of it. So we are in a position to design these systems. And one of the important things we have done is, that's what we always bio-inspired. Our approach was very close to nature. We call it as a kind of fuel-driven approach. So for example, you mentioned about the RNA, but if you look into actin, there's an ATP binding which assembles, and ATP hydrolysis to ADP disassembles the material, actin protein. So we try to extend similar things to the synthetic systems, and we could show that similar design, fuel-driven design principles are possible in synthetic systems. So now, where do we want to go? I mean, like, we really want to go further in terms of complexity, because if you simply think about a PET bottle, so this is more than one component. So there is a polyethylene and terephthalate. So when I go more than one component, the kind of materials I'm talking about, the design itself is a big challenge. So we are now trying to push it to a kind of multi-component systems. And as I mentioned, in nature, it is always autonomous. It's adaptive. But we are not smarter. We do one cycle, but second cycle, we are not able to do it. So these are the few challenges we try to address. Our dream chemistry would be to really make a kind of biomimetic protocell, lifelike material. But I think long way to go.
Very, very nice. Here, I would like to recall a few years back, I met you in a different place. I mean, in Trivandrum, where I was interacting with Dr. Das, right? I mean, you were a supervisor.
Professor Ajay Ghosh, sorry.
Professor Ajay Ghosh was your supervisor. There was a very, very interesting incident that he recalled, and then that incident is related to you. So I'm going to ask you to recall that incident. Maybe perhaps one of the Eureka moment in your life too, right? I mean, when you were a student.
So this was an interview you did with Professor Ajay Ghosh, and then he mentioned about a Eureka moment, which changed not only my life, many people's life, because it was early in 2000. So we were doing, I mean, like, we, so when I, that was first year of my PhD. So we were doing a kind of research on low band gap polymers for conducting polymers and so on. So one of the intermediate we synthesized had a kind of, we tried to purify this molecule. So it was not happening. So we were keeping inside the cupboard. And then, so Professor Ajay Ghosh was also getting a little bit impatient. Something is not happening. So one day he came and opened the cupboard. This was the incident he was mentioning to you in that interview. And then we saw that this entire conical was full of a kind of jelly material. So we were clueless at the beginning, but it was immediately we realized that it is something called self-assembly of the molecules in solvent, which goes into a kind of big structure. So that was the time, probably the supramolecular chemistry, we thought about it. And then that was the beginning. And like, it started many research fields in India after that observation. So that changed life of Professor Ajay Ghosh, mine, and probably many others. So he was referring to a student in that interview, and that I'm happy that student is me, and I'm glad that I'm here right now. So that was the incident. So sometimes in research, the observation, I'm like, some of the results are serendipitous, but we should have the right frame of mind to catch it. And I'm glad that we could take it forward.
That's actually a very, very interesting story. Like from Alexander Fleming to many others. I mean, some of these things happen by accident, serendipitous occurrence. But then, of course, you are engaged in that area of work, so you are able to actually capture its meaning and then proceed further. So that's when first you saw a self-assembly of chemical, right? I mean,
exactly.
There, as a student, you have moved on to doing research and then trying to work out, learn from how self-assembly work within cells and then create supramolecular materials. That's a very interesting. Lastly, I want to ask you one question because we don't have a lot of time now. When this announcement for Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, a coveted science award in India, I mean, considered as topmost award for science in India, when it was announced for you, how did you feel? Like, what was your reaction?
Obviously, I was very excited because, as I mentioned, during my PhD days onwards, I had the opportunity to work with great mentors, and most of them were Bhatnagar awardees. So I knew about this award for a long time, but then I'm like, I never expected at some point of time that I would receive it. So obviously, I was very excited, but then I consider this as award kind of, it's kind of more responsibilities and expectations on you. So I take this award as a kind of motivations to go and address bigger challenges. So a few years back, if you asked me this question, I never expected this award, but I'm glad that I have received it. And I consider more this as a kind of motivation and inspiration to move forward.
That has been a very, very wonderful conversation with you. I mean, hope for future in the sense that while chemistry, chemicals usually evoke fear, a sense of danger, toxicity in contemporary, let's say, public talk. You are talking about chemistry, which we learn from nature, and so would be as gentle as nature, as recyclable as nature, as smart as nature, so that a new possibility can emerge in future, which will be very different. Plastics made in this kind of a means might be not just recyclable, but also will have a circularity. That is, you can get back the same material and use it for a different purpose. Very, very interesting area of work that we are engaging in. And it's also very nice to see that such advanced areas of research are also happening in Indian labs, which is, I think, a very important message that is coming out of our conversation. Thank you for being in the show. For want of time, we may have to end this conversation here. Keep watching Eureka. We'll come back with another conversation next week, same time.